like to call the Board of Education meeting for Tuesday, June 21st, for August, please stand for the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first on the agenda, is it approval of the agenda?
Move to approve the agenda of the June 21st, 2016, regular meeting as presented.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Next, we have the election of our secretary.
I'll move to elect Mr. Terry McDaniel by acclamation as Secretary of the Board of Education for the 2016-17 school year.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any? A motion and a second, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
Thanks, don't quit.
No, thank you, Terry.
No one else can read that last name.
There you go. Okay, next we have the appointment of the treasurer.
Move to appoint Sharon K. Sheriff, First Bank of St. Genevieve, as Treasurer of the Board of Education for the 2016-17 school year.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Okay, next we have the approval of the consent agenda items.
Move to approve the consent agenda items as presented.
Second.
Motion and a second, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. For any of you out there, we get our board packets a week in advance, so we go through all the consent agenda items and put down any questions or anything that's super difficult. Okay, next we have public participation. We'll move right on to the report of the superintendent, Dr. Lindsay.
We have quite a lot on the agenda tonight, so I'll try to keep this somewhat brief. In your notes of appreciation, one thing I would point out is we have a letter from the St. Genevieve Community Services Forum that is informing us that our grant application for support for the Backpack for Fridays program was approved. And so we appreciate that. It's nice to have that confirmation of that program. So I wanted to point that out. Bond issue project update. There's quite a bit of work going on both the main campus here and then also at Bloomsdale. I talked to Keith this afternoon. They're knocking out the gym wall at Bloomsdale. They're working on that today to prepare for that expansion. And they're doing quite a lot of work here on the main campus as well. We're excited as they make progress with those, and we're looking forward to what the finished product will be and the opportunities that will provide for students. The auditor is coming. We always look forward to that. They will come for a pre-audit visit during the week of July 11th, and they will come back to complete the audit August 22nd. Kind of tying in with the bond issue project update, I want to talk about summer maintenance and housekeeping for a minute. Everything is on schedule. There is a lot going on because of the construction, but we think we have schedules coordinated in such a way that we'll be able to have things completed and be ready to start as scheduled and as was approved on the school calendar in August. So. Sometimes I look around and I go, wait a minute, are we going to be able to make it? But I believe that we can. MSBA Fall Conference is coming up September 29th to October 2nd. You guys are already registered for that. Fowler Bus Service Inspection. Annually, the Missouri State Highway Patrol comes and inspects the bus fleet by Fowler Bus Service. They came and did their inspection this year. They inspected 43 buses and all 43 passed. So they got 100% and based on the information that Mr. Gilchrist has given me, he thinks that that is 25 years in a row that they've had at least 90% passing rate. The state average passing rate is 89%. So that's quite an accomplishment, and they do a great job. Yes. Many 100%. It seems like last year there was one small issue. Nothing major.
Given the fact the amount of area we cover.
Absolutely. Yeah. I don't think there's anything with the safety update other than some drills that were completed. You might have noticed we have a lot of students here tonight. We have a couple of student presentations that I'd like to get to tonight. I'm going to start by introducing Mr. Haney, who's going to help do some introductions of the first group. So, Mr. Haney.
Thank you, sir. Basically, real brief, I'm going to introduce the coaches for the girls track team that are present tonight. They are Dr. John Boyd, Mr. Chris Werner, and our Hall of Fame coach, Mr. Brian Jett. Mr. Jett, would you?
Tonight I have five members of the girls track team that represent the school district. Made it to state meet. They were 8 in total. And like we did in the fall, I'd like to have them sign the trophy for Prosperity State. Coach again, three of note are seniors, Mallory Kohler, along here, Ryan Drew, Becker, and Becker, and Dale Warren.
Congratulations.
If I may say one more thing, also amongst those ladies, we have two state champions with us tonight, Dale Warner, who won the 1600 meter for the fourth straight time, and Maya German, who won the 3200 meter, so.
We have two members who weren't able to make it today, Madison Reynolds, she completed the 300 hurdles, and Avery Reed, she competed in a high jump, and she plays 11. Simon Fry.
How many points behind first place were you?
Is it 11 points?
Right.
MICDS won. They were pretty well loaded.
We have another student presentation tonight, and I'm going to turn it over to Christy Kleifenauer.
Hi, I'm actually just going to let the kids have at this. They're going to talk about some things that we've done this school year to promote inclusion of the ministry. And just
inside.
Cody.
I'm Mallory.
I'm Vivian.
I'm Taylor. Okay, so this year, like Chrissy said, we really worked on inclusion throughout our school. We tried to get a movement going to ban the R word. And so as you can see on that banner over there, we had a lot of our student and faculty and even family members sign to pledge to stop using the R word. And that was really to include everyone and not label anyone by a word, but really look at everyone as a whole and include everyone in everything that we do and everything that we say. And so these guys are here to join us. And we have a video, right, that we made with everyone, the buddies and the Special Olympics athletes in our school.
So we do a family.
I'm Rachel.
We're all like one of our different.
Actually went and were buddies and helped out and volunteered and just spent the whole day with them there, and it was an awesome experience. And we actually kind of created a video to showcase that. So we'll show you the video on this one. It's a short one. So. Just a nice little collage of pictures that we did.
There's a marker over there, and you guys can take the pledge with us tonight. Use the R word. Yes.
That was the one that was hanging in there when you had the jelly bean performance.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you, God.
Okay. Well, we can still get the video. Okay.
You guys done a great job. You guys are so inspirational for being their buddies. That's exciting.
One thing I did want to mention is just as a reminder, this board made the decision to add a Special Olympics coaching position.
Yes. And
of course, Christy was hired into that position. She did an excellent job this year, although, you know, the opportunities are expanding a little bit because, you know, we've had the state or the regional kind of Special Olympics competition down in Cape Girardeau. But now we have an MAAA conference, which is where the video was from. And then, of course, there's talk of bowling. It sounds like fun. I love to bowl. And then also, and this is something that I don't think they know about at this point, but we're also talking about potentially within the MAAA conference to do a buddy basketball game that each of the conference schools would host that would be on a night when we're playing varsity boys or varsity girls basketball. It'd be an opportunity for some of our students to get some exposure.
That's awesome. Because they started the basketball a year or two ago.
Not in the conference.
No, not in conference.
Yeah.
But I think just the...
Yeah, this would be an event that we would want to get media coverage.
Absolutely.
So that's something that's still in the planning stages, but something that we're very interested in pursuing. So,
that's great.
Congratulations to
yes.
all of you. Thank you. I will also provide this as an opportunity if you would like to exit. You can, or if you'd like to hang around for the rest of the board meeting, you're more than welcome to do that. I have two more items under report of the superintendent, if you would. The first one is summer school update, and I'll let Dr. Cleet take care of that.
Real quick, I just wanted to let you know that the first semester of summer school started on May 30th, ended last Friday on June 17th. We had a total of 31 students enrolled, 16 were in algebra, and 15 were in English, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we up all four of those in one session with the teacher while watching over. We started second semester this Monday on June 20th, and now we'll end on June 8th. Right now we have 23 total students, 11 in algebra and 12 in the English sections. So it's moving along. Pretty quickly, can't believe the first semester's over already. So,
in June,
here we are.
Then the last item under my report, laying on the table back there, as you can, were copies of a couple of news releases regarding some recent recognition that our Board of Education received. We have plaques that were presented to the board over there, and I want to take just a second to read an excerpt from each of those news releases. The St. Genevieve R2 School Board received the governance team honor, and it says this prestigious award is based on those school boards' outstanding commitment to ongoing professional development in areas such as student achievement, school law and finance, board operations, and contemporary issues in education. The award also recognizes their commitment to regional and statewide leadership and to active participation in legislative advocacy for public schools and the students they serve. I believe there were 16 total school boards in the state that were recognized, and our very own St. Genevieve R2 was one of those. So congratulations on that. They also were recognized as one of 12 school boards that were named an outstanding Board of Education for 2016. They had different areas. This is not the first time this board has won this award, but this time they won it in the area of climate, culture, and organizational efficacy. And there were three districts in the state of Missouri that were recognized in that area. So congratulations to the board for both of those honors. I think it just shows the level of commitment that you have to students locally in the level of participation that you have in the state organization. So that's to be commended. So congratulations.
With that being said, we were able to accomplish that, but we couldn't have done it without the faculty and the students. Thank you. If nothing else, we'll go to unfinished business, which we have now. We'll move on to new business. First is to adopt the budget.
The budget is something that, for me, is kind of a labor of love. Being a former math teacher, I've always enjoyed crunching the numbers and looking at the possibilities and trying to put together a plan, which is really what a budget is, to provide opportunities for kids. So that's kind of the way that I approach it. It is something that I do really enjoy. Before we get into the FY17 budget, I'd like to talk a little bit about the FY16 budget. You remember back to the budget update that was provided in February. Projected balances in Fund 1 and 2, which are commonly referred to as the operating funds, we anticipate spending approximately $235,000 from reserves for that budget. I'm pleased to report that we should anticipate that we'll finish in a better position than that. And I think that's due mainly to two things, one would be conservative revenue projections, and then the other would be unused contingency money that's built into the budget. We still don't know exactly where we'll finish. Still anticipate another state payment before the end of the month, but we do feel pretty comfortable that we'll finish it better than what was projected back in February. Fund 3, debt service balance will be back to the normal level since we completed the refunding of the previous bond issue. You remember we did that refunding, gosh, probably a year and a half ago, but the payment wasn't actually made until this March. But by doing that refunding, we saved the district approximately $209,000 in interest. But now that has kind of gone through the books, then the debt service balance will, the Fund 3 balance will be back at kind of the level that you're accustomed to. Fund 4, of course, is elevated because of all the bond issue proceeds and the bond issue projects that are going on. And so that will also return to a more normal level once those projects are completed and paid for. With all the work that we had going on this summer, by the time that's completed and the pay apps come through and that sort of thing, I'll have a much better feel for where we stand financially in September, October than I do now. But I anticipate that, again, in operating, that we'll be in a better position than what was anticipated back in February as far as the current budget. Now for the FY17 budget, I've talked to you a little bit about this before. My basic philosophy when budgeting is to balance providing the programs and services and educational opportunities we need for our students with being fiscally responsible to our patrons. I don't believe that we're in the business of making money necessarily. We're in the business of helping kids and providing those opportunities. So that's the philosophy that goes into the budget. I think probably at this time it'd be best to just start through the budget book. One thing just for the public to know, they get this information well in advance. They have an opportunity to look through it. So we'll go through this fairly quickly tonight, but there are some things that I'd like to highlight as we go through. So if you'll turn to page 2 in the budget book, that is basically a summary page that provides adjustments, additions, deletions, that sort of thing, that have gone into the development of the budget document, recommending a $500 salary increase on the base for certificated staff, and a 30-cent increase on the base for support staff, along with continuing to provide board paid insurances, retirement cost, and those sorts of things. And of course, also allowing for advancement on the salary schedule, both horizontally and vertically. Some other things in there, we did add a Special Olympics coach, as I mentioned earlier. Had a kindergarten teacher at St. Jen Elementary. So those things are all spelled out in that summary. If you'll turn over to page 10. Pages 3 through 9 are just an explanation of the codes and those sorts of things that are required to use by the state. From pages 10 to 102, I call that section the Why We're Here section, because really it's the summary of items from each building that the budget supports. So the budget provides the resources necessary to provide those programs and services and opportunities for kids. And pages 10 through 102, those kinds of things are broken down by building, as well as celebration of some of the accomplishments from the building, goals and priorities for the coming year, those sorts of things. It's my favorite part of the budget, even though it really doesn't have much in the way of numbers, because I feel like it forms the foundation for the rest of the document. If you'll flip to page 103, pages 103 to 106 are the various salary schedules. And then starting with page 107 and running through page 140 is a three-year comparison of revenues and expenditures by fund. So it's broken out, shows the budget year as well as the three preceding years, broken out also by funds 1, 2, 3, and 4. So that information is there for your perusal. And then if you go to page 141, then it gets into basically summary totals for all revenues and all expenditures. So it provides a little bit more detail. It doesn't give the three-year comparison, but it provides a little more line item detail as well. Page 182 is the debt service schedule. So that basically list the debt that the district has and the payments that are due during the coming fiscal year. All of those payments are built into the budget and are accounted for in the numbers. Page 183 is a general budget summary. Shows projected assessed valuation and tax rate, although we won't get those numbers until about the 1st of August. And then the tax rate won't be set until the August board meeting. This is taking a pretty conservative assumption on assessed valuation growth while maintaining the existing tax rate. It kind of gives a breakdown of collections and what the fees are and that sort of thing with respect to local property taxes. Then if you go to page 184, that is a summary of end of year balances broken out by fund back to FY 1990. What is that, 27 years, including a projection for the coming year. Obviously that projection will be updated once we have a little more information and a little farther along in the process. Balances are such that the state has
has some triggers that come into play. If you get below 5%, then they send you notice. And if you get below 3%, then it's a major issue. We're at approximately 17% in balances, which I think is an appropriate number given the programs and services that we're able to offer our kids, the kind of facilities that we have for research and things. This time, I guess I would take questions. I do anticipate spending from reserves for the coming year. That's a projection, but please keep in mind that my approach to budgeting is to take a very conservative approach, especially on the revenue side, and then also building contingency money. So in all likelihood, we'll finish better than was projected. Any questions at this point? I will say that there are a lot of people that participate in the budget process. And, you know, it's one thing that I definitely value all their hard work and input in providing the information that goes into to the budget document. It's truly a team effort. And I'm not going to try to name everyone because I know I would leave someone out. But there are a couple people I do want to thank publicly. First of all, Chris Ritter does a great job as the district finance coordinator. She's been in that position for a long time. Her knowledge and experience are invaluable to the process. I also want to thank Dr. Fleet for her input and expertise throughout the budget process. I consider myself fortunate to have someone that helps me provide that focus on what's important, because she works more on the curriculum instruction assessment, kind of the student and teacher side, and she helps me stay focused on the needs that exist there and how that needs to be reflected in the budget. So I greatly appreciate what she contributes to that process. If there are no questions, I would recommend that you approve the budget as presented. We'll do an update at least in February, and we may do one at some other time if it's necessary to do so.
I'll move to approve the proposed budget as the budget for the 2016-17 school year.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, next we have this food service prices.
Yes, let me get to federal government requires us to go through a process annually of taking our information, what we charge for student lunches. We put it into a great big spreadsheet, and it spits out a number at the end that tells us what we're required to raise our lunch prices to, or if they can remain the same. So when we did those calculations this year, it resulted in a 10-cent increase in student lunch prices. So elementary lunch for full-pay students will go to $2.60. For high school and middle school students, it would go to $2.70. Basically, the goal through that process is for districts to be required to increase their paid prices to a point to where it matches the federal reimbursement amount for free lunch. Of course, that is a moving target, but we are getting closer. Because the federal reimbursement at this point is $2.78, and our lunch prices are at $2.60 and $2.70. So, I do think that at some point we'll be at that appropriate number, and we'll not have to increase the prices. But it is required that we make this 10-cent increase. There are no requirements to increase breakfast prices. There's not a process that you go through for that, so I'd recommend that breakfast prices remain for full pay students.
students at both elementary, or elementary, middle school, and high school levels, the coach will make $1.30 per breakfast, so.
Move to approve the following food service prices for the 2016-17 school year.
Second.
Motion in the second, all in favor by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Next, we have the reduction in fourth grade section for 2016-17 at the Roosevelt Elementary.
Yeah, this is something, excuse me, this is something that we've been keeping an eye on the numbers in the third grade section that's going to fourth grade. You know, the DESE requirements are a little more lax as you get into those upper elementary grades as far as classes goes. We currently have 44 students enrolled in fourth grade at Bloomingdale for the coming year. So with two classes, that would be 22 students per class, which is well within the DESE recommendations. Also, when I looked at St. Jen Elementary class sizes for the same grade level, St. Jen Elementary currently has 91 students enrolled. There are four sections, so that would be three sections of 23 and a section of 22. So the Bloomingdale sections with two would be right in line with what we currently have at St. Jen Elementary. With that in mind, I don't see that we can continue with three sections and not do something at St. Jen Elementary as well. As I mentioned, it's still within well within the state guidelines for class sizes for that grade level. So I'd recommend that you approve two sections of fourth grade from Dell and Elementary School.
What's some of the other class sizes at Bloomingdale?
I don't have that information in front of me. That would be larger than the other class sizes, but not significantly larger. I think there's some 18 to 19, but I don't have that number. I don't have that information in front of me. I really looked more at, especially since we have people that request move from one building to the other. So really compare the class sizes of the fourth grade at Bloomingdale Elementary with the class size of the fourth grade at St. Jen Elementary. I look at that much more than I do other class sizes within the same building.
Year after year, do you see Bloomingdale decreasing much in population? Or?
No, you know, the district overall has had a fairly steady decline over the last decade. In the last couple of years, it has basically leveled off. Maybe you've seen just a slight increase. I do think that there's more students that are on the St. Jen. There's a larger increase on the St. Jen campus than there is on the Bloomingdale campus. So yes, overall, I think the enrollment is declining more.
Really?
So, I would have to double check the numbers, but just speaking off the top of my head.
The last, the biggest it's ever been is 3 million.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it is.
It's the projection show here by 3 million.
Okay, yeah. The numbers are actually in the budget.
Yeah, would you say largest?
The largest it's ever been is 392.
Back to your earlier question, second grade has 55 students with three sections, so that would be 18 per section. Fairly comparable.
It's, you know, it's fourth grade, it's kindergarten.
Right, exactly.
Questions or comments?
Move to approve two sections of fourth grade at Bloomingdale Elementary for the 2016
16-17 school year. Second.
Okay, the motion in the second, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. Next, we have tech position.
Yes, there's been a lot of talk about, I don't know if you call it a controversy, but a discussion about the city's use of funds that were remaining in Valley Springs TIF to purchase a building that was in the TIF district. Just kind of as an overview, tax incremental financing, which is what the TIF stands for, those projects are designed in such a way that they basically divert property and sales tax revenue from the taxing entities for some designated period of time. The maximum period of time is 23 years, and the Valley Springs TIF was a 23-year TIF. So from the time it was formed 23 years ago, any increases in property and sales tax were diverted away from the taxing entities to provide for infrastructure improvements in a designated area as defined by the TIF. The basic idea is that those infrastructure improvements are then there to attract businesses to locate within that area, thereby increasing assessed valuation and having some benefit back to the taxing entities that I mentioned earlier. The allowable infrastructure improvements are defined in state law. We'll look that up. It's RSMO 99.820. Include roads, bridges, water and sewer, sidewalks, traffic control systems, etc. Things similar to that. The law also specifically states, and I quote, but in no case shall it include buildings. As I mentioned before, the city of St. Genevieve used the remaining funds in the Valley Springs TIF to purchase a building that it subsequently leased to the Pita Window Company. That lease calls for revenues, I believe, in the amount of $135,000 annually that is currently being deposited into the general revenue of the city. My thought is that the funds that were left in the Valley Springs TIF should have been distributed to the various taxing entities on a prorated basis and not used by the city to purchase a building. Spoken with two attorneys that have expertise and experience working with TIFs and in TIF law, both indicated that they did not feel that it was legal for the city to use those TIF funds to purchase that building. I think the other thing that I want to mention is I don't think, based on the information that I have, that the city did this in a way that was malicious or anything like that. I think they saw an opportunity to bring jobs to the community, which is something that we support. But there is a considerable impact to the other taxing entities within the county. There have been a couple options that I've heard thrown out there. One is that the lease revenue, the $135,000 that I mentioned before, that maybe that money should be distributed then to the taxing entities instead of being general revenue for the city. I think one thing to consider with that option is that would be, if you take $135,000 and you split that 17 ways, which is the number of taxing entities affected by the TIF, then that results in a very small share, possibly not even enough to offset the loss and assessed valuation, leaving the property taxes based on the fact that the city owns the building instead of a private company or private individual that would pay taxes on the building. There's also, in that option, there's no guarantee that if the building is sold, the proceeds from that sale would go back into the TIF and be distributed or would be otherwise distributed to the taxing entities that basically agreed 23 years ago to give up those increases in support of economic development in that area. Another option, which I feel would be the preferred option, is basically that the city would pay back the TIF in full, and that that money be distributed according to the TIF documents and agreements that were in place. There is another option that is kind of a combo, if you will, of the two, and that is that the lease revenue would be distributed, as I mentioned earlier, but then there also be some binding agreement that if the city were to sell the building, that those proceeds would then be distributed. So that there would be some guarantee that the taxing entities that were involved would have access to their fair share of those proceeds at some point in the future. Obviously, the preferred option for us would be that the city would pay back the TIF and that money be distributed to the TIF as it was intended to be done. So that would be my recommendation, that the district take an official position on this, but also allow me to work with the other taxing entities to pursue some sort of a resolution to this issue, keep it out of court, those kinds of things. If there's something that is agreeable to all the taxing entities.
You just want really just from us, just for you to work with the other taxing entities, sit down with the city and come up with a plan and then present it back to us.
Yeah, and I think it's important also that we communicate that our preferred position is that the money be paid back to the TIF and it be distributed. Mm-hmm. So, right, really, that's the
sure.
That's the
that. Do you know of the money that was left, what dollar value would have came to the district?
It's a little bit difficult to calculate because I didn't have access to all the information, but it would be approximately $500,000 that we do the district. And that's a very loose estimate at this point. I think that would be so I guess having said that, I think that's a significant enough number that, you know, we want to make sure that things are done fairly and that things have been done legally, and that you know, the school district and all the other taxing entities you know, end up with something that is both legal and fair, and I think the city wants that as well. It's just a matter of trying to figure out how to do that.
I'll move to approve the district's position in Valley Springs TIF and to authorize the superintendent to work with other taxing entities to pursue a resolution to the issue.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say
aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, next we're moving on to 7E, and that's to appoint the board member. And what some of you might know or don't know, Charlie Crowther resigned his position on the board because he took a principal job in Jerusalem, I think. And so therefore, we have almost a year left, so what we're going to do is appoint him. And we had five qualified applicants, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago, we got their applications. And so with that, if anyone has any questions or anything, if not, we have a motion.
I will move to appoint James Kirshner as a member of the Board of Education to fulfill the term ending April 2017.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Welcome to the board. Well, it's an important job, and you know, if there's anyone that wants to run, the position will be open next year. And so, if I have any move on to Mr. McDaniel.
I move that the Board of Education hold a closed meeting with a closed record, a closed vote following the regular open meeting on July 26, 2016, to be held in the R.W. Thomas Library, 715 Washington Street, St. Louis, Missouri, for the purpose of discussing and voting upon the following items of business: legal action, causes of action, or litigation, lease, purchase, sale of real estate, hiring, firing, disciplining, or promoting particular employees, proceedings involving the mental or physical health of identifiable individuals, scholastic probation, expulsion, or graduation of identifiable individuals, testing and examination materials, welfare cases of identifiable individuals, preparation for negotiation with employee groups, software tools for electronic data processing and documentation thereof, specification for competitive bidding until approved and published, sealed bids and related documents until the bids are open, sealed proposals and related documents until all proposals are rejected, or any documents related to negotiated contract until the contract is executed. Individually identifiable personnel records, performance ratings or records pertaining to employees or applicants for employment, records protected from disclosure by law, scientific and technological innovation to which the owner has a proprietary interest, records relating to municipal hotlines established for reporting abuse and wrongdoing, confidential or privileged communication with an auditor, operational guidelines, policies, and specific response plans for preventing or responding to this critical incident, existing or proposed security systems and structural plans of district property, the portion of a record that identifies security systems or access codes, records that identify and would allow unauthorized access to or unlawful disruption of the configuration of components or the operation of a computer, computer systems, computer network, or telecommunication network, credit card numbers, personal identification numbers, digital certificates, physical and virtual keys, access codes, or authorization codes that are used to protect electronic transactions. I further move that notice of this meeting is tentative agenda be posted as required by law.
Second.
Motion is second. Roll call. Eric Bauer?
Yes.
David Bova?
Yes.
Terry McGann? Yes. Martha Reisinger?
Yes.
Rick Rudolph?
Yes.
Motion carried. 5-0.
Move to go to a closed session with a closed record and a closed vote after a short break.
A motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Hold on.